Should we start our session, Renu, if you're ready? Good
We
evening.
can.
Yeah, sure. Thank you. Good evening, and thank you all for joining us. Welcome to Microsoft Reactor Bengaluru Livestream event. In today's session, our speaker will be speaking about run and debug code on local while connected to AKS. Session will be approximately 1.5 hour with Q&A session. So please feel free to drop your questions in the chat box. Make this session interactive. Ask question. Speaker will try answering all your question in between or after the session. Please keep your mics muted during the session. I would now like to welcome Renu Saluja, our speaker for today's session. Renu is a subject matter expert in the evolving landscape of cloud computing and is a senior software engineer with the commercial software engineering team at Microsoft. She has been an industry expert for over 15 years. I'll hand over to Renu to begin the session. Over to you, Renu. Renu, I think you're on mute. We can't hear you.
Yeah, sorry.
Yeah, please.
Yeah, thank you so much for the lovely intro. Hello everyone. Good evening. In today's session, the topic that we have selected it is run and debug your code on local while you are connected to the AKS cluster. And AKS, as you know, this is on cloud. Let me quickly share my screen so that you know we can start go through the presentation and the demonstration. I hope now you can see my screen. Hello.
Yes, Renu.
I think this is not the right one. All the screens got jumbled. Yeah, just a second. Sorry. Sorry about this. One thing. Let me quickly give an introduction about myself. I'm Renu Saluja. I'm part of Commercial Software Engineering Group. And as part of this group, we generally work with the customer and we work help them to productionize their code. And a little bit about the today's session. In today, we will go through what if we need to run and debug our code working as a developer on my local dev machine. But rest of my service, you know, as in a big enterprise, we do have a lot of microservices. So most of my services on which I have dependencies, those are already deployed on AKS. So this is a little bit about today's session. And let me get started. So first is, as a developer, what is generally ever asked? So I'm also a developer. And as a developer, my expectation is, how can I build fast? And once I have done with my building, I need to go for testing and debugging cycle. But generally, rest of my code or the dependent services, those are on the cloud or, you know, on the AKS cluster. So how I can, you know, do those testing and debugging quite fast, being all the services deployed and, you know, already there. Another is, since rest of the things or the dependent things are on the other side, so what if there is something...
Renu, sorry to... Sorry to interrupt. I think your screen is not visible. People can see you.
Not my screen, because I can see that red line around my screen.
I think Dinesh just pinged saying that, you know, they can only see you, not the screen, the presentation rather.
You just need to click the slide.
Let me share it again, because I want to share my full screen. Otherwise, in between, when you switch the screens, then it generally break. So do let me know if you are able to see the presentation. I'm just clicking on the screen. Is it visible now?
Yes.
Okay. Because earlier also I could see that red line, but somehow it was not working. Okay, now coming back to the topic. So as a developer, our ask is, one is the fast build, test, and debug cycle. Another is, there are n number of components that will be getting deployed on the, you know, our cloud environment. And at the same time, we will be having dependencies on those and working as a developer. Can I have that flexibility? Whatever things will be deployed on that environment, I'm still able to access those without additional configuration or additional effort, at least from my module side. And another thing is, as far as all the component or microservices grows, so do I have flexibility to auto scale to that level? So I really don't want to use additional Docker configuration or some extra tools just to make my work easy. So do we have something that will automatically make all the things easy for me, whether this is my maintainability or your number of applications and debugging, testing, everything? So can I have something around this? So if I talk about, these are the very basic things that a generally developer asks, because they generally work on specific module and they want to focus, they want to deep dive in those, rather than struggling around all other dependencies. So what are the approaches that we generally have in such situation? One is, can I have everything local? So if I want to have everything local deployed, so again, the four parameters that I just discussed, so fast build and test, and stability to a deployed environment, scalability, and easy to use. So if I'm going to have everything on local, so what will happen? Everything that is already deployed on the Kubernetes cluster, I need to replicate. This is in my local machine. And with this, what will be the benefit? For me, it is one-time activity. If my environment got refreshed today, then I will take it up. It will improve my build, test, and debug cycle. But think about the effort that I need to put in, making this in sync with the cloud environment. And easy to use, in the sense it is easy to use for me if everything is updated. What if we have already added few more module on the AKS and my further requirement, they would be having dependencies on those. So continuous effort I need to put to make this in sync. So this is all about if I'm going to replicate everything on my local. What about let everything on remote? And whatever I'm going to write, I will deploy it on the remote thing. Remote, I mean to say the Kubernetes cluster. So so how it will happen, I will write my code on my local machine and to satisfy all the microservice requirements. So microservice requirement, I mean to say all the dependencies that I would be having. Let me write on local and deploy my stuff on the Kubernetes cluster. So what it will help me, to check whether my application is synced with all the required dependency, whether it's satisfied or is there any break that I can test. But how about easy to use? So what if I found and test the bug or, something which is breaking the flow? Again, I need to come back to my local machine. I need to first fix it and again go and deploy this. So it is like back and forth that will be happening in this. So two parameters that we will be really lacking is it's not definitely not easy to use. Another is deployment, testing, and debugging that is very slow in this scenario. So if you see this matrix, can we have all the benefit of local deployment, like fast build test, debugging cycle, plus remote thing of fidelity of deployment and scalability of application, and let's combine taking all the benefit of local plus it to remote, and let's take an hybrid approach. So what in hybrid approach is, we'll write our code still in local, but all the dependency requirement that is my module is having, let those being on Kubernetes, but let's build something in between, or let's the industry standard tools available in the market that will automatically bridge that gap. So my code will be still running on my local, but it will automatically connect to the cloud to check all the dependencies, pull the information, get it running. So this is all about the hybrid approach. So, and logically thinking, this is the best way because I'm still writing my code on the local, but I'm connected to the cloud for the dependent services. So whenever there will be any update on the dependent services or anything new added in there, I least care about how I need to replicate those on my local or in other scenarios for testing and debugging. Since I'm doing on local, so I need not to deploy again and again to the AKS. For that. So this is all about hybrid. But thing is it possible? Do we have some industry standard tool available for this hybrid approach? Because at high level, it looks like, you know, promising. So one thing that is available is the bridge to Kubernetes. So this is basically a plugin, I would say, that has been recently built. It was launched last year. And agenda of this specific service is you just focus on building your application and run it and debug it in your local machine. And you just use your preferred DevOps machines or your dev tools. Now let it be on this service, like these two communities, it will do everything for you, whether this is environment variable replication or, you know, making a simulated environment for you. For this, literally, you need not to have any extra assert that we generally say, whether this is a Docker file or Kubernetes manifest. So this will do everything for you. And high level, it will. What does it mean? You can simply run your code natively on your development workstation while connected to Kubernetes cluster, and it will allow you to test your code. And these are specifically very useful when we are going to talk about the large application. So let me quickly show you what does it mean. So how does it work? So for example, we do have three separate modules. And one module is my web module that is basically the front-end API. This is already deployed on the Kubernetes. And apart from this, I do have two more modules. One is the bikes, another is the reservation. So all these three are deployed on Kubernetes, but I, as a user, am going to make few changes in the bike module. So what I will do, I will be doing all the changes on my local machine. Since all other services are on cloud, what it will do, internally, this to Kubernetes service will first go to the web and it will check from where this request is coming. If this is related to my module, and then it will route the request to my dev machine and then back to the cloud once the specific module functioning is done. So this is very high level concept. When we will go through to the further step, then we will see, you know, even in the demonstration, I'll show you how internally it is working. So let's talk about like, this is the one of, you know, the plugin that really worked well. Then what are the key feature for this specific plugin? One is it simplifies microservice deployment. And it's mean it really eliminates the need of your manual source configuration and compiling the external dependencies. As you could see the previous small animation that was showing, if two other services are deployed on the cloud, you are on the local machine, then it was just routing requests to your local machine and then back to the cloud. So in this way, I need not to manually source, configure, or compile the external dependency for my development computer on my development machine. So this is one thing. Apart from this, it is very easy for the debugging. So when I generally debug my profile with the edit my cluster configuration, so it will debug my code normally as we generally do on the local debugging. So I will show you how I will just put a breakpoint in my code and request will automatically come to my local machine and it will break, it will stop or halt on the specific area for my debugging purpose. So in this way, I'm going to take all the advantage of the speed and flexibility of the local deployment. And another really good benefit is developing and testing end-to-end. As the GIF was showing, like testing end-to-end during the development time, it is really important to have all the dependencies in place. So when we select an existing service in the cluster and route our request to the development machine, where is my actual local code, it generally through the front-end application. And how this front-end application is getting bind to my local services, this is behind the screen, it is like a Kubernetes redirect call that happens behind the screen. But benefit of this is now I'm able to run end-to-end scenario. So in which my few services, like my front-end, from front-end, I'm initiating the request and on my local module. I'm getting the request, I'm debugging my code, it's taking all the data and it's going back to the cloud. So in this way, end-to-end testing is happening for this. And there are a few other benefits, I think, that we can discover while working or, you know, while the demonstration. So to understand it a little bit more, let's talk about a scenario. So think about this. What if we do have an application in which we do have several microservices? And these microservices are these can be in one specific language, and you know it can be one is Node.js, another could be in .NET, another could be in Java. So as you know, the feature of being containerizing and deploying it, we are independent and being an API. So let's assume we do have few services. One is my front-end service that is basically responsible for providing the UI to the user, and in which we can add, complete, and delete some event. Okay, and in this application, the scenario I have taken, this is just a simple to-do task. I will be just adding few tasks on the front end, and the data should go to the database. This is my few microservices, and then I do have another way to, you know, viewing at the stacks. So let's talk about the first front end that I just told you. So this front-end call is actually hitting the catalog and behind the screen database APIs, and this database APIs are going to store my data. So this is like persistence data. And for this demonstration, what I have done, this MongoDB is on the cloud. So this database is on my Kubernetes cluster. So I have deployed this. Now, my database API service that you see here. So this data database API, this is the actual service which rely on the MongoDB database for the persistent to-do items. Now, what about the other stuff that related to stats happening? So I do have statistics worker that receive event from the RabbitMQ and update my Redis cache. And in similar way, API is exposed for this to send data back to the UI part. So you can see it is having few basic services that we can have. Let me show you a demonstration so that you can correlate. So what I will do, can you see a console? Okay. So there you can see I do have few Kubernetes services deployed on my namespace, that is Kube app. So these services are database API, front-end stats API, cache, queue, and DB that I have recently talked about. And there you can see I have one specific front-end service, which is load balancer, and it is exposed to the external IP. That is my 52.143.243.50. And for the front end point of view, let me quickly open a browser, and there I will try to call this API. So what I will do, my API is so my port is IP is 152. Yeah. So this is a very basic application only for the demonstration purpose, in which you can see. This is my to-do application. There I have added through my to-do that I'm done. I can add few more. For example, I'm going to say a demo and enter. So it will add this into my stats, into my to-do item. And when I go back to stats to see the detail, there you can see I had created 5, I have completed 2, and I had deleted 1. So this is the way stats looks like. So now coming back, so this is these are the 2-3 pages behind the screen, and just to give you the background, this simple application was deployed on a microservice version of to-do application that I will share you the link for that sample to-do, so that you can also do the hands-on for this. So now let's jump into the source code. So what's happening behind the screen? So So this is my Visual Studio code. And just to give you a background, so this plugin is available for Visual Studio as well as for Visual Studio Code. So demonstration that I have now is for the Visual Studio in and then similarly we can also do for Code. So there you can see there were few services that I just talked about. Now let me share you again. So these were the services that were deployed. But for me, as a developer, for example, my core module on which I'm working is the database-API, for which I need to do all the modification in my code. So let's assume I have done all the modification. I'm doing this is on local. This, you can see this specific source code is on my local machine. And there I do have few sample files. So one is like my, a few files that I will show. One is to do task.cs. This is basically the basic data model that I will say, in which I'm capturing two basic things. One is what is ID for the task, to do task, what is title, and whether this is updated or not. And but where the actual action happening. Before going to that, let's see how it is making the database connection. There you can see it is pulling information from the environment variable. And the environment variable that is specifically looking for Mongo underscore connection string and a few more detail like database and collection that you can get it from here. Now, actual things happening is on the Mongo helper side. There you can see I do have most of the function which is basically responsible for doing all the insertion and updation of the task. So like first I'm initializing it, then whether I'm checking this, then I'm checking whether my MongoDB connection is valid or not. And then on UI side, you could see on the homepage, I do have all the tasks which were either marked as complete or those were still due. So this is about get task. Then I was creating the task. So this is about the task was created that I just set the demo task. So this function is called for creation of the task. Then when it get complete mark, then this is all about the updation task in which it will mark my task as completed that you can see. And then last, I do have an option to delete a task. Let me show you that as well, how you can delete a task. So I will go, I will select, and I will just delete it. So again, behind the screen, it's calling something. So this is the actual function that is calling. But for now, you can see everything. Since I haven't made any bridge for now, so actually it is happening on the cloud. And there you can see the URL, it's still the cloud URL. And if I will try to put a breakpoint here, and I will try to debug it, it will not work because it's still on the cloud. So next, what I will do, there you can see I have a bridge to Kubernetes button. So what I have done, I have installed this plugin to implement this in my Visual Studio. So once I click this, so since I have already done the configuration, actually what does it do? It initially asks for me, so which specific as your account you want to get connected. If I do have multiple accounts, then it will ask for the Kubernetes cluster. And after asking for the Kubernetes cluster, it will ask for the namespace name. And once I'm done providing the namespace name, in my scenario that was to do app a namespace. And once I'm done with that, then it will ask for me to the service to whom I need to connect. And there I had provided this database API. So that it can get routing to this specific service, all the traffic to my local one. So now once I say this bridge to Kubernetes, and since I'm trying to route all the data related to database-API to my local machine. So one special thing is this need to have extra privilege to make this work. So I will just, for now, I will just say permission granted. And there you can see what is trying to do is, this is my AKS cluster name, React to AKS. And then it was showing me the service name that is database-API. And this is my namespace name to which it is routing for this space name, for this AKS cluster, this namespace, and this the service it is trying to create that bridge on my local. And it generally takes some time. Basically, the first configuration takes a lot of time, but now I think it is a network issue. Otherwise, it should not take that much. Only first time due to configuration, replicating everything, it takes something. Okay. Now, on the bar, you can see the service database hyphen API is being redirected to your local machine. So it signifies that now all the requests that will be coming to the external IP will be getting redirected to my local one, local machine. And there was another window that opened. It was like this. So there you can see logs. And now, if I want to modify, I can go for the connection setting. But for now, I think I'm good. I will just show you for the debugging, how will it work? I just click on this. Now, when I will try to hit the same IPI again. So this is my IP. I'll just refresh it. So then I will try to add demo one and I will hit the enter. So there you can see it has hit the breakpoint. Now it's there. And I will just say continue. Now it will add that here. So that's how it is hitting my breakpoint. Let's explore. So there you can see external API, which I have hit. The request is routed to my local machine. And then with my local machine, all the task has been done. Now going to the, let me, just a second, hold on. Sorry about this. Yeah, so now let me remove this. Okay, first let's go to the connection setting. Let me show you a few connection settings that is applicable. So there you can see disconnect after debugging and the show connected to the information bar. So what is happening by, if I make this false, so once I'm done with my debugging, still my cluster would be, you know, my local code would be getting the request from the production environment. It still will be connected. Or you know the AKS environment. So these are the few settings that we can modify. So one was bridge to Kubernetes. That is really critical if we want all the requests routed to our local machine. Otherwise, we can make this to false. And now what I will do, I will just cancel this and let me show you. If I okay, I have just stopped this. And again, I will put this breakpoint here only since there is no bridge to Kubernetes now. And if I will try to run my application or I will hit my external URI and I will try to add one more item, then you can see, you can see this, although I was debugging on my local machine, but hitting the external, still data is there. Now I will add demo three, demo two, and although I had that breakpoint, it has not gone there because I'm not connected to Kubernetes now because I have disabled or I have stopped debugging via this plugin. So this is the way you could correlate what's the power of this bridge to Kubernetes button as a developer for debugging and testing. So this is all about the UI or you know the thing that is happening. Now let's talk about what are the things and what are the sequence of the steps that happened when we hit that button. So, so in this scenario, what is happening is whenever I hit on the bridge to Kubernetes button, it generally asks for me to configure the service, in which as I said, it will ask for me about my cluster and the port on which the local development machine where the code that I want to make this for the rerouting. And another is then the next step after prompting is it will replace the container in the pod that is on cluster with the remote agent container. So these remote agent container is basically these will be responsible for routing all the traffic to my development machine. And as I said earlier, behind the screen, it is using the kubectl port forwarding feature. So with the hit of that button, after creating the remote agent container, it will run the kubectl port forward on my development machine to forward the route, forward the traffic from the remote agent. Now, main question is, if everything is there, although it has done the port forwarding, but what about the environment variable? Because my device is still on the front end. Okay, my database is still on the on other side. So how about those environment specific variable? Even you could see that I was just using the environment dot variable name. I had not made any change. So that is basically collect the environment information from my cluster using the remote agent that was created on the second step. And this environment information will include everything like my environment variable name, visible service, what are the volume that those are mounted here. And apart from this, the secret mounts. So once it is done with that, then it will set up the environment in Visual Studio. That is basically my ID. Or if you are going to use Visual Studio Code, it will set up environment in that so that service on my development computer can access the same variable because it has already imported those variables. And now it will start playing around with the routing feature. So for me, it is just like debugging in the local, but internally it is routing the request. And once that setup is done for the environment in the Visual Studio, now it will update my host file to map service to my cluster to local IP address. So these host file entries are allow code running on my development machine, but making requests to the other services. And these other service was like inserting data into MongoDB, and MongoDB is on the cloud. So that is basically with the help of updating this host file, I could do this. And last step, it just start running and debugging my code on my development machine. And if necessary, this bridge to Kubernetes will be required some ports for the development computer that I can understand in few of the environments. It is generally blocked because a few customers, they don't want to expose their specific port. But these are the basic requirements. I think we'll talk about in a while what are the other things that we need to consider. So this is the steps that generally happens behind the screen when we hit that button. And we have already gone through the demonstration and the code you could see. I'm just using the environment variable. I haven't made any change in my code. So that's pretty look fine. But think about, so what is happening, it is routing all the requests. So whoever is going to hit that external IP, it will route all the requests to my development environment. And I think this is not an ideal situation because at the same time, we may be having multiple developers working on different modules, and they also want to use Bridge to Kubernetes features. So imagine if for each and every user, they will first get the request, route to the developer module if they have they are using Bridge to Kubernetes, send back to the cloud, then for other developer, other module, again, routing that request to that specific developer. So that's not an ideal situation, right? So what about, can we work in an isolation? And by isolation, what does it mean? Although we do have external IP that we need to hit, but for all the developers, can I create some isolation so that it is easy for everyone to test and debug their code locally, but no dependencies or, without troubling or annoying other developers. So just a simple, I would say, your code is your and no dependencies on other developer tasks that we generally expect. So just give you a brief, for this specific situation, by default, Bridge to Kubernetes redirect all the traffic for a services to your development machine because we are hitting that IP. Now, to overcome this problem, what do we have? We have an option to use that is routing capability for only to the redirected request from a subdomain. There you can see, I do have different subdomains like john.dev.apps, app and then some IP. So this may be specific to the John's local version. In similar way, Sushi can also create its own domain routing for this the specific AKS cluster functioning. So in this way, we are going to maintain that isolation through which I can have I can leverage the concept of subdomain in my development machine. And it will this will allow to use bridge to Kubernetes to deploy to develop in isolation without disturbing traffic for your full cluster. And so what are the basic thing or the basic additional configuration that would be happening? So one or the main thing that is very critical for even bridge to Kubernetes feature, not specific to the isolation, that is this doesn't work with Azure Dev Spaces. So if you already have that enabled, so first you need to disable that. And then in the same namespace, the namespace that we do have, in which we need to add route on the header, in which we will be saying the generated name. Like for John, this is like john.dev.apps. So basically the John that we have added in the front in similar way, sushi will be adding sushi.dev.app. So that my service is aware which requests need to be routed to where. So now let's have a look on the flow side, how this isolation work. So this is all about the high level flow. So what does it do? It replicates all the ingress, including whether this is your load balancing test that is found in the namespace that we had created for, and also for related to the subdomain. So it will replicate all. For example, my main namespace, or you know, the actual my ingress was service.myapp.com, and I have created my isolation, and that is with name user, some name, and with something. Now it has cloned to ingress, and now if what it will do, it will duplicate everything. Even it create an envoy port for each service, and these are basically associated with the duplicated ingress for a generated subdomain. Like for, you can see all the envoy port that we are going to have, it those are double, like here port A, port B, and till when I have found my specific dev domain. So that's how it is replicating that. And after creation of an additional envoy port for the service I'm working in the isolation, now it will allow request that is coming from the subdomain to route to my development machine. So that is, first it will pick the subdomain name, and then based on that, it will do rest of the routing stuff. That you can easily see in this diagram how it is replicating all the envoy services. So in this way, but the main thing is, each service or the cluster that, or you know, all the services which are going to have your subdomain name in their ingress, only those will be getting routed here. And that's how we are making those segregation. And in this way, it's quite easy to have that isolation. But only thing is the routing manager that is deployed, sometimes those are kept running even if you have stopped your bridge to community. Kubernetes, it's still kept running. So you need to, sometimes you need to go to the Azure CLI or using the kubectl command, you need to delete those. And those are basically kubectl delete deployment and give your routing manager a deployment name with the namespace. In similar way, after deployment, you also need to delete the services, because there you can see it is having all the services also cloned. One is the pod, another is the service which is getting cloned. So in this way, some extra effort you need to do in terms of isolation. And I hope there will be a few more releases that will be coming up with the more improved version. So this is all about how you can maintain the isolation. But what about the additional configuration? So there I had seen that, you know, we are pushing data back to the AKS. What if you want to have some more flexibility, like if you have, you're getting requests from the front end to your local machine, and to if you want to use other services which is hosted on your staging environment, for example. So for that, what are the basic things? that you need to do. So for these additional kind of configuration, we do have Kubernetes local process configuration.yml file. Basically, this file allow us to replicate environment variable. So now with the button of click, it was doing everything. We were not sure how it was working behind the screen because we don't have that control. But this file give you more control in that sense because it allow you to replicate all the environments variable mounted file, which is available in the pod on your AKS cluster. And so basically this file generally do three things. One is download a volume, set the path of that volume to my environment variable. And another is it make a service running on my cluster available to the process running on my dev machine. So that's another thing is, and last one is it create environment variable with a constant value. So earlier you could see it was just, I was just referring that, but now it is having the constant values. And these, you can see these are the basic thing that I just need to provide. What are the environment variable values? And there you can see for a few, I have just provided the fixed name, some specific version. And there you can see the volume mounted. I have just given my local path name. So this is the way I have more flexibility for the additional configuration that I can have. Now, once we are done with that, with additional configuration, so let's talk about something that we should aware when we are going to work with these two Kubernetes. So thing is, as we were talking about, as you have seen in the flow, and also frequently talk about, the thing is about the pods that you generally see. So first limitation is a pod may have a single container running in that to have these two community for the successful connection. So that's one thing, and I think that's very critical. That's how it is able to route all the pod requests, because it's running on a single container or the pod just to my local machine. Another is currently these two Kubernetes pod is supporting only Linux container, and in upcoming releases we may be having Windows container, but as on date, it is not supporting Windows container. And third is these two community Kubernetes need to have some extra permission to run on your local computer. That you could see when I try to hit these two Kubernetes button, there it was asking me for the additional permission that I need to have on my local machine to. And those permissions were basically in order to edit my host file, because in the flow you could see it is going to edit my host file to make that entry, okay, which specific request is going to map with the host name and the local IPs. So that is again very critical to run this successfully. And another is that I have already talked about is, if you have already enabled Azure Dev Space on your Kubernetes cluster, then we can't use this. So that's another limitation for now. So these are, I think, four critical things that we need to keep in mind while we are going to use these two Kubernetes. But I think overall, this is really a fantastic service that we can leverage as a developer, and we have lots of things to experiment around it. And again, this is an open source. And if you want to have a look about what is in the backlog for this service, so what are upcoming or in progress for this plugin. So just a brief, so at high level, we do have four basic requirement or the requests. Those are in progress. One is compatibility with the sidecar and Dapper or service mesh. These are heavily used in the industry. So now this is a request, and that is in progress, and we are going to have it very soon. And another is admin-less solution based on AKS service variable. Another is for additional security, we are going to have pod identity. And another that we already have, but we still need to have a lot of improvement, that is related to the Visual Studio Code. So you will see many more feature coming into Visual Studio Code as well related to these two Kubernetes plugin. So these are the high level four things. Those are currently in progress in the roadmap. And apart from this, since there are many Java developers currently in the market who also leverage AKS. So those are in backlog and like supporting other IDE other than, you know, Visual Studio and Visual Studio Code. And those are in backlog. And apart from there, there are other cool features that are still in pipeline that you can see. And I will share you the link where you can see what are the actual features that you can leverage, or you can you know, see what will be upcoming and what is done. And if you find any issue, then again, it's an open source. You can go ahead, you can raise a issue. And if you want to contribute there, you can just go there, create a pull request of your work that you have done to improve this plugin. So that's it from my side. Any question, anything that I can help? I can see there are two chats. Yeah. Any question for me? And one thing, I'm available on LinkedIn. I hardly get online on Twitter, but yeah, majorly on LinkedIn. If you have any question even after this session, please feel free to ask me. I'm happy to help there. Okay. There is a question from Vivek for some resources for this, like code, tutorial, and docs. Definitely. Really good documentation about is related to Visual Studio 2019 page. Let me share in this chat window only so that this is handy for everyone. And I'll share this PPT with everyone. So so there is really a cool application which is built to play around this. One is the to-do application which I have shown you. And apart from this, there is another application with name bike sharing app. And even that you can have a demonstration for this in channel 9. You will see the program manager of this open source plugin. He has talked about that. So this is Bristol Kubernetes. A Git repo in which if you want to contribute, you want to have a look in the sample, there you can just go and have a look. And there they are going to talk about three different applications that you can play around. And if you go to Microsoft document is in chat related to Visual Studio Code. There you can see Bridge to Kubernetes that you can explore. Let me send you that link as well. So, this is about Visual Studio. Now let me also give you link for Visual Studio Code that you can use. And now I'm going to share link for the Visual Studio Code. So this is all about Visual Studio Code. I think these few links are really useful if you want to play around with this service. And you know, very basic thing that you need to have. One is Visual Studio Code. You need to have your CLI and this external plugin to make this work.